I'm Jackie Brenda from Smelly Dog. Thanks for tuning in today for our Yappy Hour series. Today, I have Michael Moorfield from the Arizona Animal Welfare League, and he's at the shelter today with a super cute shelter dog. So we'll be talking about what he's doing during the coronavirus time with all of time, and he's got some really great ideas about what you can be doing at home. And Michael chose a whiskey neat, which I love. It sounds very fancy. And so the dog drink today is called a Whiskers Neat, which is just a whatever your dog's drink of preference is. So I'm going with bone broth. I love bone broth for my dogs. And neat means there's no ice, there's no mixers or anything in it. It's just a straight up broth. That's what we're drinking today. Welcome to the show, Michael. How are you?
I am great. Thank you guys so much for having us. This is Fisher's big media debut. So we appreciate you guys being able to showcase us.
So this is Fisher and you're at the shelter with him.
Yes, exactly. So we have not closed the shelter for care of the animals. We did close for a small period and did a lot of adoptions. And now we're doing appointment-based adoptions on the weekend. But the care to our animals has always continued 24/7. We've still been able to take dogs in from our partners across the state. We've been doing our owner surrender programs. We're actually the only major shelter in the Valley that's still doing owner surrenders for those who really have that last resort of not being able to care for their pets during this time. And so Fisher here just came in a couple of days ago, and he will be looking for his forever home this weekend. And then hopefully he finds it. But if not, we have volunteers that are fostering all of our animals. So you come to the shelter and there'll be like two or three or four dogs. And it's really funny because they'll be going on three, four, five walks a day or like five or six puzzles. And at the end of the day, the dogs are like, look, it's been a lot. I just need a minute. So it's like the exact opposite of what you think of as a shelter. These dogs are the most well-behaved and exercised dogs in the world. So Fisher's been making new friends with his volunteers, and he's been making friends with all of his staff members, and hopefully he gets to make a new forever home this weekend.
I am so excited for Fisher. I want to see that sweet face. Hey, Fisher baby. Hi, Fisher baby. I know he has that little tuxedo on, the little white stripe down his front, and I saw his cute little white paws. It's just adorable. So I'm so excited for Fisher. I know he's going to get adopted right away. And so tell me, Michael, because I hear all these stories about how shelters are empty and how adoptions are up. Are you seeing that here in Arizona as well? Hi, Fisher. Hi, Fisher.
We really are. So it's different. So people, if they come and visit our shelter, they're going to like, oh my God, it's so empty. Right. But that's because we placed, hi, hello, sir. Because we place so many animals into our foster homes, we're still doing, you know, 30, 40 adoptions a week of dogs and cats, sometimes more. So we are still taking in a lot of animals, but if you go to the shelter, it's really empty. But what we did see is a really big jump in adoptions, and that is fantastic.
Amazing. Yay!
Yes, so great, right? Besides the fact that you get to spread the word of adoption and why it's important. And so when you're having conversations about why adoption's important, spay and neuter's important, all of those things, you now have a new fan base. But besides that, this is a really great time to add a pet to your home. You're home all the time. You get to spend this bonding time, this quality time. You get to really develop what your personal relationship is going to be with them. And so it was really cool that this is the way people stepped up. They could have stepped up by buying out bags of flour and learning how to play new video games, but instead they spent it saving lives.
Right. Well, I love that you said that because you are so right on the nose with that. I remember when I got both of my dogs, I got his puppies and I was working a full-time job. It was before I had Smelly Dog and a corporate gig. And I would, because puppies a lot of times need a third meal. So I would drive. I lived like 20 minutes away from where I work. So I would drive home every lunch hour so I could feed the puppy and let the puppy go out and put them back and then, you know, come right home from work, So this is a great time because even if you're still working, you're working from home. So you have that ability to do the meals that they need, the walks that they need, the training that they need. Oh, look at him. I mean, he's adorable. I want to take him home.
As you can't see my face right now, but you can probably still hear me, he is a giant, but he's a gentle giant. Like I said, we only met a few minutes ago, and he's already like, I would like to be your best friend. I would like to climb in your lap. Yes. See, that is what we would call a reasonably sized lap dog.
Yeah. So this is Mr. Bond. This is actually the bigger of my two. He's twice as big as the other one. This is my old man, Mr. Bond.
Yes.
Look, Bond, do you see Fisher? He is. Look at him. He wants to be a lap dog.
He does. He loves being a lap dog. And so this is something you get to realize. So let's say you adopt Fisher this weekend. You get to work on, you know, reminding Fisher what it's like to live in a home. He might not have lived in a home previously to this, or he may have lived outside, or he doesn't really, you know, understand what new people are like. So you get to have those experiences with him. But on top of that, you get to teach him things like boundaries. I love Fisher, and I'm probably not going to teach him boundaries in the next few minutes. But let's say you're living with Fisher and you need to do web videos or do an interview for Smelly Dog or do a Zoom call with your work. You're going to want to teach them boundaries and tips and tricks to make it easier for both of you, whether that's learning place where they have a big dog bed where they like to sit and relax. So that way when you're on a call, they want to enjoy that time with you, but on a dog bed and not in your lap. Yes. He's now drinking my extra cup of water. I love my whiskey neat is at home. I'm at work and therefore I have a professional environment. But I always want a little bit of water in my whiskey. It helps the notes a lot. So if you have really strong whiskey, it's like this, right? And you add water, it's like this. What happens is you bring those notes together and it really exemplifies the flavor. I will not be using this water because Fisher is now drooled in it, which is totally fine. But like I was saying, you want to provide a really fun environment that it respects boundaries, because if you set those boundaries early, you can still snuggle. You can still watch TV on the couch. But when they know that you're on the computer, they can lay on their dog bed and be very happy. Really important when you're doing teleconferencing. Or, you know, this is a really great time to work on your enrichment skills. And that means building puzzles at home. God knows we all have a billion Amazon boxes sitting in our house right now. You should be throwing treats in there and turning them into giant puzzles, because I need 20 minutes to grill up some food and put it on a plate without my big handsome man here in my lap. If he's solving and breaking down a box for 20 minutes solving for his dinner, that's a great enrichment activity because it's mentally stimulating and it will keep him busy.
Yeah, and it'll be so easy. You take your Amazon box, poke a few holes in one side that are little, put the treats in, tape it up, and let the dog have some fun with it while you're cooking dinner. And
Have you seen people like buying more toys and puzzles now that they're like, I'm home all the time. My dog has destroyed every toy he owns and I'm going crazy. You're like, yes, buy this.
Well, it's funny that you ask. I do encourage people to do puzzles and to do toys that are stimulating to a dog's mind, not just their mouth. So we get a lot of questions about indestructible toys. And I will tell you, like I tell everybody, oh, there's his sweet face. There's his sweet face. Look at that little white on his chin. So handsome. So I'll tell everybody that I do not believe that there is such a thing as an indestructible dog toy. You have to find the toy that is right for your dog's size and their chew level. And there are certainly many toys that are much better than others. But think about that, whatever you're spending, if it's $8 or $10 or $12 or even $20 for a dog toy, as that's a small investment in time to keep your dog's mind engaged, keep their energy level. So whether it's a tug toy or a puzzle or a ball that you're throwing, and that if and when they destroy it, because over time, eventually they will, well, that was a good, you know, $12 investment instead of your dog eating your couch or learning bad behaviors, like going potty in the house and that kind of thing.
Absolutely. And I 100% agree with you. We go through a lot of toys here at the shelter, and we have dogs with no teeth. to brand new puppies to giant horses like Fisher. There is no such thing as an indestructible toy. We've seen the full spectrum. There are really great toy companies that always put pet products first. Yes. Westpaw is a good one. Kong is
I love Westpaw. That's one of my first ones.
Yeah, they are so great. They're very durable. And that's why we're saying things like durable, not indestructible.
Right. And not just durable, but they also use clean materials. And when I say clean, I mean, there's no sort of toxins in them. The dyes are kids friendly. Everything that they, they're eco-friendly. So, lots of good stuff going there with that.
Exactly. And those are really important. And so, and we go through a lot of those, but like, if you take Fisher home, you know, you're going to want to buy the tough toys. You're going to want to buy those because they're more durable, but I'm glad to hear that people are like, what puzzles are out there? Like, what do indestructible toys are out there? Because this is a big time. And what I think people are going to be dealing with in a couple weeks when they start going back to work, besides these sad eyes looking at them right in the facers. Oh my God, you're a ham.
Look at him. He's adorable. And you know what? I think he's had some training because he keeps offering you his paw.
He's definitely had something in his life where he gets the human contact and the human bond. But what I'm worried about is when people go back to work, that one day on a Saturday or Sunday, you're hanging out with your pet. It's been 2 months maybe. And then all of a sudden one day you're gone. And you're gone for 8 hours or 9 hours. You know, you might have accidentally undo all of that kennel training you worked on. You might have undone the routine that dogs thrive on. Dogs thrive on routines. And you might have accidentally undone all that by being home for 2 months. So, you know, people are going to start running into maybe a destructed house, maybe a house that has a missing couch or something like that. And you're going to want to determine, is it boredom or is it separation anxiety? Boredom means you buy them lots of toys and you keep them busy and you go for some extra runs. Separation anxiety will probably involve a professional, maybe a veterinarian, a behaviorist. It's a little bit more intense. So I've told people that if you're worried about when you leave, start setting up that routine now. Maybe go for a walk by yourself. Maybe go drive and watch the sunset by yourself in your car without interacting with other people to stay safe. And kenneling your dog, if you usually kennel your dog, or give them that time to themselves, because you're going to help develop that routine back in place. Because if you have to, you know, come home to an eaten couch, or you have to buy a webcam, which I highly recommend if you are having, you know, destructive behaviors in the house, buy a webcam, because you can buy one at Home Depot for $25 and you can watch, are they bored and they hate your couch because they're bored, or do they truly have separation anxiety? And those videos will help you work with a behavior person on working through some different ideas. They'll be like, yeah, you need to go buy a Westpaw gift certificate and load up. Or they say, we should probably talk about some other angles. Because Fisher, if you adopt Fisher right now, Fisher's entire life is you being home all the time. He doesn't have what the normal life is going to be like. So you want to start working on that in advance to make sure that you're happy, a happy couple after.
Well, I love this, Michael. I love that you're giving my audience a lot of good information, because right now they're spending so much time with their dogs. And then when they do go back to the work, the dogs are going to be, like, what's going on? Where are you? So setting them up for success. I'm a huge believer in kennel training and giving dogs the right amount of space for success. So think about that when you're setting up and making sure that their kennel or their pen or wherever their little room is, maybe it's the laundry room or whatever, where they go when you're not there, is a happy place and it's a rewarding place. So it's really positive reinforcement for the dog. So I love all of this information. This is great. And you know, Michael, I did not invite you for a cheers. We should have a little cheers. I know you've got a little doggy slobber in yours.
you're cheersing with Fisher.
Yes, cheers, Fisher, and cheers, Michael.
Hi. It's a very rough day here at the kennel.
Yeah. Now, I am not normally a straight whiskey drinker, so I do have a little chaser here.
Totally fine. One of my other favorite drinks for happy hour is a Cuba Libre, which is just a rum and Coke, but you have to add the lime and you have to have the Coke from Mexico.
With the real cane sugar, right?
Yes, it's the only way. It tastes better with the rum. And then, you know, a lot of people just put rum, Coke, all the day. But with that lime juice on the rim, that is my home go-to drink. You know, like if I'm having people over, that's the house drink, is the Cuba Libre. But like we pointed out in the past, alcohol is very, very bad for your dog. So if you're having friends over, make sure it's on a countertop and not on the ground. Because as good as it tastes to you, thank you, exactly, he won't be able to get anything. But Fisher here, on the other hand, he's tall enough to get it off the counters. And so for every time you make a tasty, flavorful, fruity drink, they will probably want to get into it well. So make sure it's safe. And like you said, provide something that's fun and enriching for them, like your broth drink.
Exactly. So that's why we've got our whiskers meat, my little drink here today. Pim Pim, you want some whiskers meat?
Huh? Exactly. No, exactly. So have you noticed that your dog's getting into any trouble since you've been home? I've noticed new behaviors of my dogs. Maybe they've always done this. Maybe my 8-year-old dog has been doing this for years, but I've discovered that I've been blaming him for stealing things that the younger dog has been stealing the entire time.
Uh-oh. So you've got the one good dog versus bad dog, but now that you're home and you're seeing it, maybe that good dog was a little naughty.
Yes. I have to like change the picture on the wall and be like, no, you're the good dog this week. And that's nothing. Every dog is a good dog. But I am hearing really funny.
Do you have your dogs in a pyramid? Like, did you ever watch, what was that crazy reality show where the girls dance? It's Dance Moms. Do you have your dogs in a pyramid like Dance Moms?
Yes. I just flip it on Mondays. Monday is the day, and we go through, and then there's an Excel spreadsheet. We determine value points on how much trash they got into. Addie stole half an extra large pizza off the counter, out of the box. An extra large pizza. I have trouble moving it around comfortably. She stole it off the counter when I was in the other room and got almost the entire pizza gone.
Wow. So I assume you have a big dog then who can counter surf?
I have two. So I have one tall dog and one very strong dog. She's just tall enough to get onto the counters, but she has like the leg strength of an ox. So she'll stand there and just look around. She'll spend minutes determining what she wants to steal, but she's also deadly silent about it. You never heard her steal anything. She's always quiet. But the best part was when I came inside, the other dog, Riker, the one I've been blaming for stealing, he was the one standing over the box, not Addie. So he got blamed. I had to go back and watch my webcam to determine who actually stole my pizza. So I've discovered during this quarantine that my dogs may have habits I never knew about.
Well, that's funny, Michael. And so to answer your question, I have my older dog, my first one. He's 14 now. He'll be 15 this year. And actually, Miss Penny will be celebrating. This is Penny. So she'll be celebrating her 12th birthday next month, won't you?
Oh,
yes.
Happy birthday.
Yeah, she thinks she's a puppy and she acts like a puppy. She still runs and plays and just, she's never had any medical issues or anything. But she's always been my naughty dog, and Mr. Bond has been my good dog. Now, Mr. Bond, he had a rough teenage, right? He liked to chew mommy's expensive shoes. He knew the difference between expensive Italian leather and other shoes. And so we went through a phase, it was about a 4-month phase where Mr. Bond just could not resist mommy's shoes. I have a closet where I don't have doors, so it's like an open closet. So he got banished from the bedroom really quickly because he went there. But after that, he has always been the best dog. He's good with my kids and just really a good boy. And Penny is very mischievous. She's always been the naughty one. And she's very spiteful. So she loves people. But Penny's not so much a dog's dog. She likes interaction with people. Whereas Mr. Bond loves doggy daycare. He loves going to daycare and stuff. So Penny, during other times, there are days where she would decide she didn't want to go to Smelly Dog with me. She'd be like, So she'd go and get back in bed. And I'd say, Penny, we're leaving. If you want to come, you need to come. And she'd just be like, nah, I don't want to come. Well, it seems like halfway through the day, she forgot that she didn't want to come. So she would do things like her favorite thing is to get the toilet paper and to shred it. And she's actually really good. Like she can really do a number on a living room with toilet
paper.
That's
like a criminal charge right now with toilet paper.
Oh, right now? She hasn't done it since we've been home. But right now, could you imagine? Could you imagine people would freak if a dog took the toilet paper? But anyway, since we've been home, this is funny. I hope you like this story, Michael. I was doing a Yappy Hour last week, and it was actually Mr. Bond who, now he's old now, he's 14, and he's a bit blind. And so I kind of think that Bond is just, he has that old man attitude, like, I don't care, I'm so old, I do what I want. But you don't really see him do anything naughty.
Right.
Well, during my Yappy Hour, I didn't let him finish the doggy drink because I thought it was a little too much. And so I set it on my side table. And so he smelled it. He came up, he got on top of the table. He knocked the drink over, all over my papers, which were my notes. Like the professional I am, I kept going with the interview and didn't let it bother me. And so then he takes the bag of treats that I also have on the side table, and I have it open, and it's a big bag. And he like whoosh, knocks it off the table, and it comes like upside down, treats everywhere. So finally I have to be like, okay, I'm so sorry. I've got to pause the Yappy Hour because my dog was just going to town. He would have just gorged himself. And I was like, really, Mr. Bond, out of nowhere. He was like, I want that Yappy Hour drink. I want the treat.
Yes.
And so he did a number on my Yappy Hour last week, didn't you?
It's been an act. He spent the last 10 years planning for this moment. And it was over yeah.
Oh,
him.
And you know what else, Michael? I caught him digging. He's never been a digger. Neither of my dogs are diggers. And I have a cute little courtyard off the side of my house, and then we have our backyard, and he was digging where I have a tree, and it's like these bricks in the courtyard, and the tree's right in the middle, and he was just digging. So anyway, I think he's got a little wild hair. He's like, I'm old, I don't care anymore, I do what I want.
Uh-huh. And on top of that, you know, think about this, is you've got, you know, your dog may be taking an 8-hour nap a day. You know, like my dog is kenneled while I'm gone in a big kennel, but she sleeps most of the time. Now when I'm home, she has to get up when I get up. She lays down. Even though you tell them to stay quiet and relax and just enjoy their day like normal, they keep following you. And they are exhausted by the end of the day. But yes. Also, you are kind of accessing, kind of like when, if you have kids, they kind of sometimes act out, you know? And so he's like, look, I just want to take a nap and I'm tired. I'm going to go dig in that backyard because I'm going to develop bad habits because I don't feel mentally stimulated. I don't feel comfortable, whatever it is, because they're so used to you having a window of time to play with them all the time.
Michael.
Now you have all day and they're like.
True. And Mr. Bond, I think he really misses doggy daycare. He loves doggy daycare. And of course, we've had to close all of our services for social distancing. And so I think he misses that. He misses interaction with the other dogs, and he does sleep. He probably sleeps 20 hours a day, but yeah. When he's not right now, he sure is finding a couple of ways to be naughty, so, aren't you?
And have fun. It's very simple. It's just like you're saying with doggy daycare and boarding, you know, if your dogs are used to being around a certain group of people all the time or a certain group of dogs that they're friends with, they are pack animals. They have communities. They love building these relationships. So just like us, you know, Fridays or Tuesday nights, we're used to meeting up with our friends and playing board games or grabbing cocktails. What? And then now it's all gone. We are having emotional and psychological issues. That's no different than your dog. If you're used to doing something all the time and they fall into that routine, like I said, humans and dogs are pattern-creating animals. And dogs, if you always go to doggy daycare and then he goes, where's Rufus? I haven't seen Rufus in 2 weeks. Where's Nanette? I haven't seen Nanette in playgroup in 2 weeks. Absolutely, that's going to be emotional for them. And so you have to take those things into consideration. But absolutely, it does not surprise me that you have clients and your dog saying, you know, when can we safely do this? Because my dog needs friends. They have FOMO.
Yes. Mr. Bond, do you miss Miss Bella? Bella was his napping buddy. They'd play a little and then they'd nap, right? Our two little old dogs at doggy daycare. Do you miss Bella? I bet you do.
You miss your friends and your dogs can miss their friends.
We certainly miss all of our doggy daycare friends. And that's another thing that people who are adopting dogs for the first time might think about if they're worried about going back to work and maybe their dog not knowing what to do. They need somebody to trust to exercise their dog or do something while they're at work. As long as their dog gets along well with other dogs, That's a good thing to look into, is doggy daycare.
It really is. One of the hardest things is, unfortunately, when people have to surrender their pets. We treat it as a very difficult but empathetic situation. You don't know the full story. You don't always know why the dogs are coming here. But that's why we set up appointments and we are able to do the intake of owner surrenders. So, you know, one of the hardest things that we have is people saying, I'd like to surrender my animal. We said, you know, this is the situation. We totally understand. We need to do a dog test and behavior test. It's fair to the people. It's fair to the dog. It's fair to us. And they said, well, the dog has never interacted with anybody outside of my family in 4 years. The only dog they know is the neighbor dog that they bark at. And one time my uncle brought a dog over 3 years ago. And so we have to start from the ground up of developing social habits and meeting new people. Now, I'm not telling you that you should take your dog out to meet tons and tons of strangers, but your dog should become understandably polite around people. And you're, hi, is this your camera shot now? Is this, I'm kidding.
I love his silhouette.
I know, right? And your dog should become as dog socialized as they can. There are rare cases of dogs that have reached a point in their life where they may not be able to socialize with dogs going forward, but you always have the ability of working through that. But it's really hard when people have to surrender their animals and they have zero socialization with dogs, zero socialization with people. So I've always been a big proponent of dog parks. I've been a proponent of doggy daycare. I take my dogs to the farmer's market so they can meet new people in a very controlled and polite environment. But please, I 100% agree with you. Socialize your dogs. Find a way to keep them active if you're gone. Doggy daycares, play groups, all of those things, those resources are out there, and it will do wonders for your animal.
Absolutely. Now, Michael, tell people who are listening and watching about how they can help. How do they do adoptions right now? Or if you need foster people, how do they get involved?
Yeah, absolutely. So we are still providing as many services to the community as possible. And one of those services is our appointment-based adoptions. You can go to our website at aawl.org. There's a big banner right there in the front that says appointment-based adoptions. And what you'll do is you'll fill out a matchmaker guide so we can help match you to the right animal that we have available. And then you'll be able to schedule an appointment. Now the appointments are filling up fast, but people cancel all the time. And they are held on Saturdays and Sundays and sometimes Fridays. And that is the main reason for our adoptions, is so we can take in more animals. You know, for every animal we adopt out, we can bring in more animals like Fisher and like, puppies that we brought in from our partner just today. Those are really important because that is how we can continue to serve as that community resource. So if we can't adopt animals out because we're closed, we aren't able to do those owner surrenders and provide that benefit to the public. And so that's why our adoptions are very important. You can learn all about that. On top of that, we have seen a drop in donations. And, you know, this is a time a lot of people are in hardship. And there's a lot of people that are losing their jobs. And so we are seeing a decline in adoptions. And we do ask, anything makes a difference. Any amount can make a difference in the life of a homeless pet. It could be as simple as a couple dollars to buy extra treats for Fisher so we can work on his dog socialization. It can be $100 to help make sure that he gets his spay and neuter surgery and provide spay and neuter surgeries or vaccines for other dogs. Every bit makes a difference because we don't get tax dollars. We don't get money from the sad commercials on the national groups. This is our community coming together to raise money to keep our doors open. And our doors open every single day because we receive that support of our community. So it can be a dollar, it can be $5, it can be as much as you can possibly give. And there are some parts of the CARES Act, that the bill that passed, that allows some above the line donations that can help nonprofits. But also spread the word about adoption, spread the word about why it's important to support your local community. And we're all in a very tough spot right now. So my most important thing to ask people to do is pet their dog. Spend time with them. Tell them you love them. You don't know what tomorrow brings. You don't know what the next month may bring. The life is always changing. Spend a couple extra minutes today, pet your dog and tell them you love them, because you will never regret it.
Yeah, and it does the dog good, but it probably does you even more good.
It does. It lowers your blood pressure. You will live longer. There are scientific studies proving that petting dogs is a health benefit. Now, try and claim it on your insurance. I don't know if that'll work, but if it does, that'll be fantastic.
Right. Well, Michael, thank you for the work you're doing. It's important.
Thank you so much.
And you're passionate about it, and I love it. I love to hear all that you're doing and everyone who's volunteering and helping out at the shelter. Thank you so much. Our best wishes for Fisher to be adopted this weekend. Hey, Fisher. Oh, what a good boy. There he is. What a sweet boy. And thank you again, Michael, for joining me today. Cheers to you and your efforts at the AAWL. Stay safe and stay healthy during this time. I'm Jackie Brenda from Smelly Dog, and this is our Yappy Hour series. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in today.